My mama always said life was like a box of chocolates.
Thanks for playing with us.
You never know what you're going to get. What's up? Lieutenant Dane Taylor in the house. Unreal. Robert, thank you so much for the like. I much appreciate it. That's very kind of you. Well, you guys, it's finally here. I can't believe it. Lieutenant Dane! He's finally here, y'all. And we're kind of homeless at the moment because we just moved to a city and we have really not but the stuff in our shopping cart, the things in our pockets. Oh, also, bam! We took our helicopter from our time in the military. So Lieutenant Dane, although he is a man of limited means, motherfucker's got a helicopter. What's up, Robin? Watching from work. Appreciate that. Please don't get in trouble watching at work. I'll make sure that I curse real loud and say a lot of bad things and get you fired. Tell me your boss's name so I can scream your boss's name when stuff happens in city. They'll be like, what the hell is Robin listening to? Well, Robin, since it's just you and me at the moment, I'm very excited to debut this character, and I'm purposefully doing it at a time where the city is quiet because the last thing in the world I want to do is figure out how to do this when the city's super busy. So that being said, Lieutenant Dane is in the house. And for right now, I would say Camp Freedom is home. Fight for our human right to housing. I agree. I don't know if there's anything out here. I just kind of landed here and claimed it as my own. So we're going to do a quick social justice for all. I also agree with that. What is in here? Semi-exciting things, though, because now that I'm released from all of my previous honor codes, Lieutenant Dane has no moral compass, y'all. And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm a little excited to explore the city without a moral compass. I mean, look, I'm not going to get carried away. I'm still going to be the same guy, right? I'm probably going to be a good-natured criminal, but I am going to be a criminal. And it'll be exciting. I've been in this city. I've been RPing for almost a year. And I've been in the city for almost a year. Actually, just over a year now. And I can honestly tell you guys, I have never attempted to do life in the city as anything other than a good dude. So I am excited, a little bit nervous. I don't feel like I'm altogether ready for this. But at the same time, I mean, I feel slightly pigeonholed in my role in law enforcement. And I don't know if that's common for a lot of people because I never felt that prior to. Before I joined law enforcement just, like a month and a half ago, before I did anything with law enforcement, I felt like I was pretty happy with where my RP was within the city. And so I wasn't lacking. There wasn't anything that was missing for me. But the deeper that I go down law enforcement, the more, I'm going to say this very gently, but the more stifled I kind of have been feeling. And it's just been growing, a growing sentiment that I've been, that I've been having for, yeah, like I said, probably about 2 months now. And for whatever reason, I just can't seem to shake I'm potentially missing out on RP that both me and my character could benefit from. And so, what's up, Travis? Good day to you, sir. Thank you for the like and the share. I'm going to give you your back-to-back booze here. And you, sir, get your ass up to the principal's office right now. And yeah, so as Travis has put in the chat, YOLO, you only get to really live in the city once, and you only really get to do the city once. So yeah, I figured I would maximize my opportunity to expand a little bit more and learn a little bit more and grow a little bit more as both a content creator and a citizen of MetaWorld. There's obviously probably more than half of this city that I have not explored with bad intentions. So with that, I definitely want to try and take advantage as much as... What the hell is this? Crafting table? Oh, cool. I want to try and take advantage as much as possible to see if I can inspire a new class of criminal in the city. I had griped about it the other day while I was on patrol. I'll try not to do too much cross-promotion and cross-talk. But yeah, while I was on patrol, in my police officer character, I couldn't help but feel like there was elements of the criminal class that was just kind of missing. And I don't mean that. I know how disrespectful that must sound. But it feels like crime in MetaWorld had been done, or has been done, a very specific way for a period of time. And it's gotten fairly predictable. Again, not in a bad way. Like, you know, these things happen. You do the same thing for long enough, and it's gonna have an effect on both how the police department develops strategies and protocols. The more that something specific happens, the more people are able to build strategy and policy around that. And so my aim is to come in and bring something to the city that this class of criminals has not seen before, and that's being able to utilize a helicopter. Chris Owens, thank you so much. Welcome to the hangar. So I'm going to bring a class of criminal that's just different. Not better or worse, just different. And it's going to unlock, I hope, the creativity.
I hear you.
The creativity that some people feel. And I'm looking forward to seeing what...
You can
really buy one. How interesting. I'm interested to see what it unlocks for other people in terms of their creativity. How we can go ahead and use the helicopter in ways that maybe we... haven't thought of before. Shit, maybe ways that I haven't even thought of before. So okay, so I want a couple sandwiches here. We'll get a couple bottles of water here. Actually, I don't think I'm gonna need a bunch of sandwiches, maybe just two. I'm gonna need a lot of water. I'm keeping these in my wallet just because I think it's funny. And we'll go ahead and take two armor. That's gonna hurt. Yeah, that's most of my money right there. All right, so we got to get on this grind. Man, this struggle is real. Are those cockroaches? Wow. Listen, I don't know if I've ever noticed that before. That's really interesting. So, random side fact about me. My wife and I, since we first started dating, we've been together almost 10 years now. When we very first started dating, we used to play this really harmless prank on each other, and it has not stopped for almost 10 years. We continue to do it. And it's not something we do every day. Usually it's the longer it takes to plan it, usually the better it is. But we have, and it's related to those cockroaches. So the story is, there's a tie-in here. But we have this rubberized, very, very realistic looking cockroach. That's made out of rubber. It's the same size and it's the likeness of an actual cockroach. But it's obviously made out of rubber, and it's perfectly colorized. And so what we do is we hide it from each other and we put it in places that we normally would use. And I don't know why that just reminded me of it. So, all right. So yeah, the grind is real, and this is just too much. Okay. I'm going to put one of the armors on right now. But we need to start making some money, like in a pretty serious way. One of the things that I was able to do just to kind of get in and get settled in the city is I went and I started mining some of the rocks. So I think first we are going to get, I think we're going to get some of these rocks, or rather these stones, processed out. And we're going to check a few things in terms of payout. I'd like to see if I obviously don't have enough money to get the tools to make jewelry, but I'm interested to see what the jewelry prices are going for lately. Also need to figure out honest ways to make money, because I don't have any criminal ties to the city just yet. So for that, let's see here. I don't know anybody. I have nobody in my contacts. It's slow work. So what I was thinking is I've got some basic supplies, and whose turn is it to hide the roach? I actually just got my wife 2 nights ago. So technically the roach is in play, and either I haven't found it yet, she hasn't hidden it yet, or I guess it can't be both. It's got to be one or the other. She's either put it in play or she hasn't yet. One of the more epic ones that she got, I'll take off here in a quick second. We'll fly around. We'll get started. I just want to finish this story because I'm going to get sidetracked if I don't. But one of the more epic ones that she did for me recently, I think I've mentioned this in the stream before, but if you're relatively new to the stream or you're new to my content, I am, in fact, a executive protection bodyguard, but I work with high net worth and celebrities here in Los Angeles. I'm based here in Los Angeles, but occasionally my clients will travel for work or leisure. And I had my most recent work trip was to New York. So I went from Los Angeles to New York, and I was with my client there for about 2 weeks. So obviously I had to pack quite a bit of stuff, including all the things that I need, you know, toiletry wise, my toothbrush and all those things. So my wife managed to get the cockroach into my toiletry bag, and I did not notice it until I was into my second day in New York. I was actually getting ready in the morning and was going through looking for one of my straight razors to trim kind of the side of my beard. And I saw that she had placed it in there, and I just could not stop laughing. The fake cockroach traveled all the way across the country, made it into this beautiful hotel, and I had to then try to hide it because I didn't want the housekeeping staff to mistake that it was real and throw it away, because it's weirdly like we take care of it. We take pride in it. So that was one of my favorite ones that she did for me. One of my favorite that I've actually put on her, I hid it in an ice cream tub and froze it. So when she was eating ice cream, she was found it, and I thought it was cool. All right, let's get out of here. Enough about me, enough about me. It's all about Lieutenant Dane Taylor. Welcome to MetaWorld, sir. Let's go get your inaugural flight. First, I would just like to quickly point out, this is the Frogger model. It's slightly different, and that was done with intent. I wanted this to have a noticeable and marked difference from my other helicopter, the Super Volito. And that's because this is literally going to be used for nefarious and otherwise criminal enterprises. So the side of the helicopter, as you can see here, is TP Enterprises. which I'm going to be for just, I don't know, we'll say the immediate future, I'm going to be taking over. It's name and likeness because that's the only thing I can paint along the side of this helicopter. And then as you can also see, let me get a little bit closer here. As you can also see, it also says, fuck the feds and pants out, dick out. So, yeah, anyway, that's a just kind of a life philosophy, I suppose. It's going to be an interesting time in MetaWorld, y'all. I'm excited. I'm excited. All right, so we are live in MetaWorld. We have a criminal character. My criminal character owns his own helicopter, does not have a place to live, does not have a friend, and does not have any business associates. So you are witnessing truly and truly the birth of whether or not this character can exist in the wild. And it's an absolute experiment. This is a sociological experiment. We are trying to see if this kind of personality can exist in MetaWorld. I'm not going to be a ruthless, you know, drug lord. I'm not going to be a somebody that instills fear in people. I genuinely want, no matter what interaction I have with you, I want to have a good interaction. And that's criminals now, specifically leaning more towards the criminal element. Obviously, I've been enjoying my time with law enforcement, but it's very easy to have good interactions with law enforcement in that way, especially if you're one of them. So I wanna reach out and seek out and start having relationships with other people in the city that normally would sort of be off limits to me because of my role in law enforcement. Travis is asking me, how much did I pay for the helicopter? I paid $10 million for this helicopter. And that's all I will say. I want to see if it's possible to land here. It looks like it's...
Thanks for playing with us.
Looks like there's a little bit of an upslope. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to aim this out to the ocean here. And that should give me just enough of an upslope. You would like the stream right when I'm trying to land, Vaughn Mitchell. Appreciate you, though. Yeah, that's an aggressive up pitch, but doable. Definitely doable. Doable in real life as it is in this game. That's enough of a slope. I'd probably be, I don't know. I'm gonna give Vaughn his booze real quick. But I would say that's probably right on the pitch. That's probably right on the pitch limit that I would be comfortable landing in real life on. That's very aggressive, but doable. So some things that I'm looking for, just so that you can, just so you guys can kind of get an idea of where my head's at with this. What I'm looking for are areas that are far enough away from the map. They are hard enough for law enforcement to get to that in a pinch, we would be able to come to and drop. So like, you know, say we're in the middle of a police pursuit of some kind, and you know, we're being pursued, being able to come right down here, coming in and landing, and then having a secondary escape modus ready, where there's either a boat or another helicopter. If I end up making connections and teach a few people how to fly, we could potentially do, you know, vehicle swaps, like come in, land here. Police are still trying to figure out, you know, they're coming down through the trails and the trees here. I've already landed. This gives me an opportunity to get out of the plane, grab everything in the trunk, look for a secondary vehicle, and I'm already away before the police can even physically get down here, realize that I've switched vehicles, and come up with a plan on what to do. In my opinion, I don't think that anybody in... Well, I'm going to say this a little bit arrogantly, and I apologize for how arrogant it sounds, but I don't think there's anybody that can fly with me. So utilizing some drop stuff would just be kind of a fun way to make it a little bit more fair. And again, I apologize or how arrogant that does sound, but if I'm constantly getting in like helicopter chases, I don't think there's going to be too many instances where, unless perhaps if I do something to screw up, I don't think that there's going to be a helicopter pilot that I've seen in the department that's going to be able to maybe do much without getting into, you know, some higher specifics. But you know, maybe like the Townsends and the like, people that are government officials might be able to outfly me. But who knows? I don't know. And that's the other thing. Because I've only ever used my helicopter service stuff for, I'll say air quotes, for good reasons, positive reasons, legal, morally abiding reasons. I've never actually gotten to test myself in that way, right? I've never been in a police chase. I thought I was definitely a lot lower under that bridge. That's the other thing, is I'm learning how to fly a brand new helicopter. This helicopter is very fat. It's very slow. I don't particularly care for the way that it flies. It also has 120 pounds of rock in the back. So yeah, it flies like a tank right now. It's not very maneuverable. It doesn't want to do what it's told. It actually, one of my, probably the biggest gripe that I have with this particular helicopter is that it does not maintain altitude well. In turns, it tends to drop altitude. Like you see, I just dropped about about 3.5 feet in a slight pedal turn. That has nothing to do with the weight that I'm carrying. It just has to do with the style of airframe. It's not as fun. It's definitely not as performance-based as the Super Valido. That helicopter is an absolute... I don't even know how to describe it. It's amazing. It's all around. It's probably the best helicopter that I've been able to find in city, so... All right, I'm here to pick up some apples. One of the things, unfortunately, that comes with the switching over to a criminal character is that I now have to manage my stress, which is not fun. So, yeah. We've got to pick a few apples every now and then to maintain, because every time I go up and fly, apparently you get really stressed out when you fly. So, apparently you need to eat apples to de-stress, and apparently there's a faster way to do this, but apparently I don't have any friends in the criminal world yet, so for now I'm just going to have to sit here and get my Adam and Eve on. So I'm going to pick a few apples here, and then I think... once we get some apples picked, maybe we'll go over and we'll chop up some more wood. I currently have lumberjack rolls, but I need enough money to get a knife so that I can start doing some farm work, and I can start doing some of the slaughter. Ultimately, just trying to spread myself across a few industries here, and in the hopes that I can, excuse me, scrounge up enough money, hopefully buy myself a vehicle, and start getting around the town and start meeting people, because I would have to imagine it's going to be pretty difficult to use the helicopter to meet folks, if you know what I mean. Not that it's hard. People see the helicopter, they're going to obviously want to know who I am, but I don't know if I want to lead with that. That makes sense. Although if that thing lands, I'm for sure stealing that, because I miss flying that crop duster. That thing is so much fun. Please land. I would love it if you would land. It's going to sharp right turn, though. Damn. I'll keep an ear out for it. If it lands, I'm totally flying it. Thank you, Travis, for the followage. 270 motherfucking days. That's impressive, dude. I really appreciate that. You damn near out of a year, bro. I've only been doing this for less than that. I've been in the city for about a year, a little over a year now. I've only been streaming for probably 6 or 7 months. So if you're following me for longer than I've been streaming, you are a real one. Appreciate that. How we looking? 30 apples. Probably pick about maybe 40, 45 of these bad boys. And then since we're relatively close to the logging area, we'll go ahead and hit a circuit of chopped logs. And then I will process out the rest of these rocks. Once we have all of our wood, we can head over to the quarry area where you process that stuff out. And we'll see where we're at money-wise. Oh, you know. Okay, so yeah. Travis is an OG OG. That's the day I became known to MetaWorld. Yeah, I think you spelled it right. Hmm. It's quiet in the city right now. I think there are 14 people in the city. So the likelihood that I'm even going to meet anybody, even if I was driving around, is probably slim. But, I had to get in. We had to get streaming. Lieutenant Dane deserves to be in the city. And, yeah. So who is Lieutenant Dane? Who is Lieutenant Dane? He looks like, if you pull up a picture of Lieutenant Dane Taylor from Force Gump, he is a dead ringer for Lieutenant Dane post-Army. And Lieutenant Dane post-Army, if you remember from the film, unfortunately, during combat operations in Vietnam, suffered the traumatic amputation of both legs. And so when I was coming up with the character idea, I love Force Gump's one of my favorite movies in general. From a directing standpoint, from a writing standpoint, from an actor standpoint, from just an original story for one human being that can have just an incredible, amazing life on accident. You know, it's very endearing, and I won't go too deep down the rabbit hole for what I'll say next, because I'm skirting some lines of confidentiality agreements that are still in place. But I have professionally worked with multiple members of that cast, and they have absolutely, in more ways than one, lived up to their reputation, but also just the human being behind the characters. And as a fan of both the characters and the storyline, it was very refreshing to meet a few of the people behind some of that story, and see kind of where those things were brought from, where they were based on, and methodology used to create some of that character. And so to pay homage to that, and this is just my own kind of creative way of navigating that space, this is my way of paying homage to Forrest Gump without bastardizing and coming in here as Forrest Gump, which I think it would rub a lot of people the wrong way, because it would be trying a little bit too hard. So what I did is I took Dane Taylor as a character and his name and likeness, and I've sort of imported and hybridized his character and behavioral traits with Forrest. So as I interact with people in city, I'm going to try my best to incorporate some motif and behavior from Forrest Gump. I'm not going to be Forrest Gump, right? I'm going to be kind of that, just a simple Southern man, that has a good nature. But under the surface has a ruthlessness to him that he tends to mask with playfulness and cleverness and thoughtfulness. So I'm going to try really hard to see where this goes. And you know, obviously I don't want to be so good natured that the city takes advantage of me. Right. So that's a little bit of my thought process.
Thanks for playing with us. Have a great day.
Oh my gosh. I have been picking some apples, y'all. Mr. Otis, welcome to the hangar, sir. Thank you for the like. You get your ass right up to the principal's office, sir. All right. So, let's go over to the lumber yard. I need to give this a quick... In fact, I might be able to go right. Let's see if I aim right for that ridge line. That notch up by the top of the ridge line there, that little notch, that first notch on the left. If I aim right for that and come straight down, that should probably put me right online. I'll put me right online with the lumber yard there. So we're going to shoot for that.
Thanks for playing with us.
And I have the unpleasant task of trying to figure out how to climb this damn helicopter while still maintaining forward speed. Addy Cash Gaming in the building. Welcome to the hangar, Addy. No ice cream for you, Don. You're late to the party, brother. To be fair, and this always happens, I swear to God, every time I sit down and I try to plan... Like, I genuinely try to plan out having a stream of some kind or a storyline or something that I actively want to work on. I try to come in bigger parts of the city. Don, thank you so much. Let me get you your boo. I try to come in at busier times in the city to work some of that stuff out. But because this is a brand new character and because I don't want to talk to anybody yet, I tried to come in at an off time, which is a lot earlier than I would usually come in. It's 10:45 in the morning on the West Coast now. So this is not a busy time in the city, and there's not a lot of streamers on. So in any event, you might be asking yourself, why would I come in and do it? That's exactly why I would come in and do it. I want freedom of movement. I don't want to be hassled. I kind of just want to get in and get settled. So we're trying to... I've shot this approach a few times, so this is not... It's a confined space landing where there's not a lot of forward, aft, and side spacing for me. But there's also that damn light pole, which I'm always worried about with the rotors. So I have figured out a way that this is an easy way for the helicopter to fit when I need it to. And Travis, yes, I agree, man. That was an awesomely emotional day. It was one of those, what do they call them? Core life memories. And I mean that. It was. You know, that's... If I have to be honest with you guys about, you know, why I have chosen to stay in MetaWorld, where I have seen other content creators, fellow content creators, and in some cases friends of mine leave the city. I make no mistake about it. I'm as honest as I can be. The reason that I continue to stay in MetaWorld, and I think for now at least will always stay in MetaWorld, are from the events of that day specifically. It touched me deeply to be on the receiving end of something that I typically do for a lot of other people often in my personal life. I've not had an opportunity to do something like that in MetaWorld. But in my personal life, that's something that I get a lot of joy out of, is being able to show up and be there for people in big ways. And so to finally feel and be on the receiving end of that, and to have all of that happen on a day that that mattered, you know, this is one of those things. Like, I get kind of emotional even just thinking back and talking about it. So, you know, it had very little to do with the computer. It had very little to do with, you know, how the community, you know, physically showed up for me in that way. It was the way that the community acknowledged me as one of their own, welcomed me in, and basically all but rolled out the red carpet for me. And I'm an introvert, so when things like that happen as an introvert, you're blown away kind of like twofold, because it's something that you're not expecting. And in many cases, it's something that you're not, I wasn't physically built for. I'm not physically built for the good nature of people coming back to me. It's a struggle of mine, if I can just be honest with you guys. Accepting compliments, allowing people to show up for me in ways that I show up for them. It's not an intuitive thing my brain likes to accept. So yeah, so MetaWorld became a core memory for me, in a sense that not only was Townsend the reason that I started RPing, joined MetaWorld, you know, he was the reason that all of this started, this entire journey started. And then to have him then also be the person responsible for sending me a computer and organizing him, obviously with Boog, them both organizing that outreach was, I mean, shit, it happened almost, not almost a year ago, but it happened quite a while ago, and I'm still talking about it, and I'll probably never shut up about it, because, you know, I have this saying that I use in my personal life. I say this to anybody that will take 5 minutes to listen to me, but how you treat somebody that can do absolutely nothing for you is the truest sentiment of who you are as a human being. It may, in those situations, you might as well, when you're nice to somebody or you're outgoing or helpful to somebody that can do absolutely nothing for you, that's God holding up a mirror, in my opinion. That's what I believe. In those situations, that's God showing up and saying, all right, let's see who you really are. Can you be nice to somebody when you benefit? Yeah, we all can. That's super easy. Should I could do that on a Tuesday. You know what I mean? Like, it's, if I stand to benefit from being nice to you, all of a sudden I have motivation to be nice to you, right? And it's disingenuous, but it's motivation. If I'm being nice to you, or I'm showing up for you, and I get nothing but a thank you, or in some cases I don't even get a thank you, are you still motivated to do the same thing? Are you still motivated to show up in the same way that you would have had you benefited? If the answer is yes, then you need to come sit at my table, because I need to hang out with you. Because my daily conflict is feeling like I struggle being a good person to people that don't deserve it. That's when Don discovered me as well. Don, is that true? I didn't realize that. Is that when you discovered me? I mean, I would have to imagine, unless people are like just found me last week or something. I would have to imagine if it wasn't the guitar man moment, I don't know how else you guys would have found me, you know? Because most of the people that I end up meeting, as time goes on, I would say probably 90% of them are here in city. So my reach is not, I don't have a digital reach. Facebook is really the only platform that I've used. I mean, I stream out. I stream on Twitch and YouTube. But I invest absolutely no time, no effort, no energy into growing any parts of that channel. So,
thanks for playing with us. Have a great day.
I appreciate that, Travis. It's a simple philosophy, but it's actually probably one of the hardest. Addy Forth, what's up? Appreciate you. Appreciate the OGs that come in on their gaming pages. I'm not one of those people, by the way. If you have a gaming page, come in here and promote, please. Please. I'm serious. And I don't mean that like pejoratively. I genuinely, if you're on a gaming page and you want to come in here and say what's up, get your ass in here and say what's up. I know there are certain streamers that don't like people coming in using their gaming page. They look at it as like a form of self-promotion. And that's understandable. I understand. I get it. But you know, my algorithm is set up that I want to see the people that I interact with the most. And if I'm interacting with my gaming page, it's going to bump you to the front of my stuff, which allows me to send stars and comments and likes and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, I feel passionately about showing support to other people. So I say all that to say this. If you come in and support me on your regular page, Jay Renee, thank you so much. If you come in and support me on your personal page and your gaming page, man, you double stars for you. I appreciate you guys. I remember stuff like that too, by the way. And it's not, you know, not tit for tat. Like, I'm not a monetized site. I don't plan on being a monetized site. So when you guys come in and show love and spend some time with me, that to me, that's everything. So when you guys do shit like that and you show love to me, I come back and I show love to you. And usually my way of showing that is I'll come into your streams and I'll drop stars. I'll drop likes. I'll drop comments. I try to make a lot of comments and a lot of likes so that it helps with all the stuff that you guys are trying to do in growing your pages as well. Because there's absolutely no point in one person getting bigger than everybody else in the city. If none of us grow together, then the city's not going to grow and the pasta is not going to grow along with it. So it's advantageous for me on a professional level to help grow the content creators around me. But it's also really beneficial for me on a personal level, on a very personal level, to grow the content creators that are around me, because I personally suffer from imposter syndrome, and I would love, I'm fortunate, I'm blessed in MetaWorld specifically. I'm all through with my wood. So I am fortunate and blessed to have people that hype me up and are constantly trying to push me to do more stuff, both in city and in life. And, you know, I deeply appreciate when people show up like that. So when I'm fortunate enough to have people show up in my life, I like to be that reciprocating light to other people. And it's very specific. Like, the less that you deserve it, the more I want to give it. That's how it works. That's how it should always work. Mike and Bria are pregnant. Listen, look, I just bought these today. I have two condoms in the next time. See, y'all should have been careful. Y'all should have been careful. Mazel tov. That's amazing, though. I took y'all on a great date, and it looks like y'all are starting a beautiful family. That's amazing. I'm so pumped for you guys. Lieutenant Dane will happily take you guys on helicopter rides off the books, and Kyle Patrick will happily take you guys on another date night on the books. You let me know. But Lieutenant Dane and Kyle Patrick are always at the service of Miss Addie. And, yeah, as a matter of fact, I'm doing the lumber job to make some money because I don't have any criminal friends yet. So for everybody that's watching this, listen, shameless plug, Daddy needs a job. Daddy needs a job. Daddy needs friends. Daddy needs all of the above. So where are y'all at? Let's go. The condoms don't work. Aria had to take a plan B. Oh, my God. you get the coins because that made me laugh. That was a genuine laugh. Thank you for that. My police officer character, I have, if you guys have at all been following parts of my stream, my police officer character, Kyle Patrick, was doing a training ride the other night, and I found two babies. One baby was in the street, just south of Legion, and somebody else had, apparently it was a safe surrender, or it looked like a safe surrender. Somebody left a baby in a bassinet right at the front of MRPD. And at the time that I found the babies, I wasn't aware that we had babies in the city. So that was how I found out that you could have children. Yeah. baby Carlos. I miss baby Carlos. I miss baby Carlos deeply. I got to figure out a way. Maybe I got to get a surrogate. I'm going to have to get a surrogate, or I'll adopt. I got to adopt a child. Or you know what? Maybe I'll be a little bit more responsible. Maybe I'll just get a dog. maybe I should get a puppy. That'd be kind of cool. Maybe Lieutenant Dane should have a puppy, and we'll call the dog Forrest. This is my dog, Forrest. What do you guys think? Is that stupid? Okay, good. I'm glad it wasn't you guys' baby. That makes me feel good, Addy. We couldn't find the parents, and I guess at that time, MRPD wanted nothing to do with it. So rather than doing the honorable thing that we should have done, which is find the damn parents, we had some people come in, some higher-ups come in, and just think about CPS. And they made the problem go away. Like Kevin McAllister, I made my family disappear. All right, we are in the area of the lumber. So we're gonna drop the lumber off first, make a couple of bucks, and then we're gonna go process out some of our rocks, make a couple of bucks, and we're gonna see where we're at. Financially speaking. Hey, real quick, y'all. I mentioned this to you guys a few times. I'm gonna pull up into a little hover here while I say this. This is not a monetized channel. I do not accept stars and donations in that way. But there has been a major, major milestone that has just occurred that I am not altogether comfortable with. So, can I just say very quickly, and I'm saying this extremely humble. Y'all, we got double digits watching me right now, and that's the first time that I think I have experienced double digit numbers watching me live. So I'm looking at 13 people right now in the chat, and you guys, that's very f***ing cool. That's very, very f***ing cool. So thank you guys so much. Elite Pierre in the building, thank you so much for stopping by. That man is affectionately known as Stab. And Stab, I got some great news that I have you specifically. There's a few people in the city that I've been looking forward to chatting with, and you, sir, are one of them.
Thanks for playing with us.
There was a missed storyline. Montanique Buckner, thank you so much. Lenwood, good Lord, you guys. Everybody pulling out tonight. Thank you guys so much. Really quickly, though, back to my statements with Stab and Elite Pierre Gaming. There was a storyline that started to happen with Stab back in the day, and it actually kickstarted my law enforcement career, as it were. And the deeper that I've gotten into law enforcement, the more I have genuinely regretted not being able to utilize anything with Stab back in the day. So Stab, bro, we gotta talk, man, because Lieutenant Dane Taylor, he is at your service, my good man. Lieutenant Dane Taylor is at your service. So let's talk. I got a little business proposition for you, my guy. All right, let's sell some wood for this joke of a price. All right, every little bit helps. You know, you ain't going to get rich cutting down trees, but we do what we must, right? All right, now I need to head over. I have a little landing spot that I like. It's about right. It's kind of in this little gap area right here. Whoa. Lieutenant Dane Taylor at your service. He's a simple man. He's a hard worker. He'll do just about anything you ask him. You give him a Dr. Pepper. Oof. I once saw this man drink 14 Dr. Peppers. And he told the President of the United States that he had to pee. I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it. I'm just hoping I don't get shot directly in the buttocks. The Army said it's one of those million-dollar wounds, but they must keep that money because I ain't seen a nickel of it yet. I do have my body cam on, but look what it says. Read the letters. Read the letters. It says Lieutenant Dane Taylor. And it says United States Army pilot retired, sir. Offer him a Canada Dry. I must drink me about 14 Dr. Peppers. All right, we gotta hit our approach here. Come over the top of the road here, and we'll just kind of cruise this in. Watch this. This is actually one of the more technical and difficult approaches that I do in the helicopter. The room for error here is very little, and that's one of the reasons why I love coming in here and flying it, because I know for a fact if somebody tries to steal the helicopter, there's no way in hell they're getting it out of here without breaking it. So if I can't have it, you can't have it. Kind of a thing. But we're just gonna sit this big old girl right down. Nice and easy. Like butter. He didn't even notice. Well, boy, you better notice. It's the little details that make it, man. It's the little details that make it. I work hard on stupid shit like that nobody really pays attention to, so that in the event that you see it, it's kind of cool. But I also, full disclosure, I'm also trying to make it look like I'm not trying too hard. So yeah. Oh, I can't carry that much. Okay, so what do I have that's heavy right now? The drill is probably heavy.
We hope you've had a wonderful flight, and again, thanks for flying with us.
Oh, the trunk is full. Okay, so let's do this.
Thanks for flying with us.
Man, y'all are crazy. TJ, what's up? Welcome back to the hangar, and thank you for the share. I think you did that in reverse order, though. You shared before. You shared before you liked it, so you got those in reverse. KC is old and can't see the small print. Oh, there we go. That's taking it back right there. Offer him a Canada Dry ginger ale. You funny. Addy says, your graphics look good. Do you have a graphic pack? No. I am a level up. Put the drill on the ground. Oh, okay. Well, I don't want to leave the drill. I mean, I kind of still need it. I don't have a graphics card, but I am now a level up. So I don't know if that's affected my ability to... Shit, I am going to have to put this drill on the ground. Man, you right. Hey, watch this. Hey, Stab, watch this. Look how you out there inspiring the world right now. Teaching people how to drop things. All secret and shit. Hey, look what Stab taught me. See, Stab? Look at that, man. You can't say I didn't learn nothing from you. Oh, that did take out quite a bit of weight. I appreciate that, brother. Thank you, sir. Let's see what we're working with. All right. Maybe we take about 20 of these. That'll work. Maybe we take about 5 more. Maybe we take about 5 more. Nope. And pick it up after I finish. My man. There's obviously another way to go in, but this is more fun. I'm glad it's still here. It's also a good way to quickly check. Like when you come in, you can kind of see who's down. I mean, obviously it's slow in the city right now. And how I know that it's slow in the city is that 11 you guys are watching me. That's how slow it is in the city. Because if I'm not mistaken, let's see, there's only 11 people. There's 11 people watching me and there's only 11 people in the city. So you have limited options for your content viewing pleasure. And for whatever reason, I appreciate that you guys are wasting your time with me. So thank you. I mean that. All right, let's make a little money. I wish that there was a more stimulating way to speed through this. Usually in the post-production, you can just insert the fast-forward motif and then, you know, skip to the part where you're rich. But unfortunately, you guys are just going to have to listen to me talk. And so while we're doing this, while we're cracking some stones and making a few bucks, I'm going to keep my attention over to the chat. 11-11 are some numbers. Make a wish. Oh, hey, do you do that too? That's cool. So I have this weird thing. This is going to be one of those things where I'm going to say something and then, like, when I go back and rewatch my stream later to pull clips, I'm going to freaking wish that I hadn't said this. But you know how we all have, as humans, we all have that, like, the shared experiences, little things that happen to us that we share that we don't really talk about. Like, it's part of the human experience. I've been having this thing happen to me since I was a little kid where ever so often, probably either... It happens probably two or three times every single week for most of my entire life. I'm 37 right now. And it's, I'll happen to look over at the clock at 12:34, at 1, 2, 3, 4. And every single time that I catch that I've noticed that the clock is at 1, 2, 3, 4, I'll immediately figure out a way to go find something, whether it's on my phone or a digital clock somewhere, or I'll look at my watch, and I'll wait for it to hit 56 seconds so that the clock literally reads 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but it's only for that brief second, right? Because like at 11:11, you get an entire minute. At 12:34, you get an entire minute. But at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that's a one specific intentional second that happens twice a day. And out of 24 hours, there's literally 2 1-second windows to be aware of that time. And I'm so sorry for how weird this is making me sound right now, y'all, but that's my wish. Those are at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that's when I'll close my eyes and I'll say a quick prayer, a quick wish for myself or my family. But hey, I like the 11:11 because it offers me an extra opportunity for another wish. So that's kind of dope, and I appreciate you for that. Oh, dang, I need to... Yeah, see, so I'm not alone. I know it's one of those, like, weird shared things that happen as humans that, like... You know, there's another one. My wife and I were just talking about this the other day. Do you ever have... And just for the record, and this is more just for comparative purposes, but neither my wife or I have any issues with our hearing. We don't have any issues in either of our family histories. We don't currently experience any hearing issues or hearing loss. Hey, hold on. Somebody remind me to come back to telling you about the hearing because we have a VIP in the motherfucking house right now, and that is Finn the human. That man is my very good friend. So the story about the hearing thing is, there's a couple weird things that happen to people that it happens to all of us individually. And I think a lot of us internalize that and think that it only happens to us individually. So we don't ever talk about it with other people because it sound or could potentially sound weird or make us sound weird to other people. But I was having mid conversation with my wife, and I had my right ear like started ringing for like a second, and I was like, oh damn it, there's that auditory thing that happens every now and then. It's like every couple of months I'll just be sitting and for no reason it just feels like the hearing in my ear will go out like for, I don't know, 30 seconds or something like that. And it's happened to me most of my life. And so I've just, you know, it's one of those things. Like, I thought maybe it was just something that was happening with me. Maybe my ears were going to go bad at some point. But in the middle of a conversation, I kind of stopped and my wife looked at me like, what's wrong? And I was like, I just had this weird like auditory thing. I lost the hearing in my right ear for a few seconds. It was like ringing really loudly. And she looks at me and she goes,
thanks for playing.
You get
us.
That too?
Have a great day.
It was so cool. It was very cool. A gentleman and a scholar. Hey, you better stop with that nonsense. Coming in here with your personal page and your gaming page and your text messages and your good nature. You sir, you can right off. You get an extra boo. You get an extra boo. Let me switch profiles. All right. So you are very familiar with the area in real life, but being the MetaWorld realtor, I noticed the houses are similar in real life. As a matter of fact, that is fairly true for the most part. In fact, I can give you when we get out of here, I'll give you guys a quick aerial tour, and I'll talk about if you guys are not native to California, or if you've been to California or stayed in California for any period of time. Los Santos, San Andreas, the island, Los Santos proper, has done a very, 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 very good job of capturing Los Angeles as it is. And I mean that. And in some cases, the surrounding area as well. There's some areas that we kind of, in California, we jokingly and laughingly make fun of. I'm sure there's places like that everywhere. You know, you've got the nicer parts of town, the average parts of town. And then you got the parts of towns that everybody kind of clowns on. And, you know, there's parts of that, obviously, in California. And Los Santos definitely, MetaWorld specifically, has figured out a way to really make this area feel, and I think that's truly, if I have to look at my reason for getting acclimated in the city so quickly is because I can pull from real life and it saves my ass more times than it doesn't. And I mean that genuinely, because when I first came into the city, it was so overwhelming to try and figure out where everything was. And in some cases, I'm still very much lost trying to figure out where everything is. Pulling from real life and being able to know, like, okay, well, sort of geographically, I know where certain things are and I can pull from that, but it doesn't help me a lot. I mean, it really doesn't. There's parts of it that do, but it does not give me a great deal of knowledge beyond what I kind of bring into the city. So let's do 20. No? What do I have that's so heavy right now? Probably the armor. Let's see if maybe I can put the armor in here. No, I cannot. Let's try. I have 15 rocks. And then we'll just add 5 on. And then we'll just add 5 on. I feel like that's what I tried to do earlier and didn't work. Yeah, so I'm out here grinding because I don't have any friends yet. I haven't met all my criminal friends. Double the booze, double the fun. Oh, I hit the cough button just in time. You guys are so lucky. Speaking of the MetaWorld realtor, I need to meet with you real soon. You know, my goal, Addy, is to buy another house for my criminal character, so I'm going to have to meet with you as well. And if you are still in the chat, Addy, as the main realtor, I'll say the main realtor, fuck, the only realtor I'm ever going to work with in city. Do you know if the furniture situation has been resolved? Because I would very much like to start decorating the inside of my house. And at the moment, I don't have enough money to do that without, well, not on this character anyway. I don't have enough money to buy stuff, set it, and then come back to find it gone. So if that's been fixed, let me know. I'm available in the afternoons. Yes, he is. That's what's up. I love that. I love that. I gotta drink some water. I'm getting a little thirsty. Getting a little thirsty. Beat the heat, old army phrase. He knows. He knows. Elite, all of my, that's me calling the stab right now. All of my experience in the military has come from the United States Marine Corps. So, again, I wanted to push myself a little bit outside of my comfort zone to do the Army, but I don't know anything about the U.S. Army other than the stuff that I've picked up from my dad, who was a Marine, and my time living on Marine Corps bases, and the times that my dad did a couple of joint tours with the Air Force and the Army. We got stationed all over the country when I was a kid, so had a lot of experience with the Army, but not any direct. They were always kind of the butt of a lot of jokes, unfortunately, so I feel like my knowledge came from a very biased and heavily skewed holding tank. I do know, though, and this will be something that I can bring in. I'm gonna make sure that I tell everybody to change their socks. Make sure you keep a fresh pair of socks on. Foot hygiene is very important. Oh, Addie says she's had luck at Aria and Juan's, but had some stuff missing at Bria and Mike's. Okay, so some stuff is working, some stuff not. So she's saying about 50-50. Okay, I appreciate that. That's about what I expected for where we were in the city for now. So I think I'll casually start decorating Kyle Patrick's beachfront property. And I'm obviously still a long, long ways off from being able to afford a million dollar establishment. It's cool. All I know is Army. My man. Yeah, not to drag you into a personal conversation on the stream, but since you are here, and since the question is floating around in my mind, you can just give me the middle finger and tell me, nah, I don't want to answer that. And that's cool with me too. Mike Jones to the principal's office, please. Mike Jones. But Mr. Stab, if I remember correctly, I thought I remember seeing something that said that you were going to be going back into the Army pretty soon. Is that true? Is that something that you feel comfortable answering and or talking about? Because that would imply that you were already in the Army, have separated, and have since decided maybe you want to lock down a couple more years of doing some fun stuff. And if that's the case, I have even more respect for you than I already had. If it's not the case, the fact that you already served, I have so much respect for. But more than that, more than just your exploits in the real world, one of the things I like most about you and a lot of the people that I with in chat and in city is that you're just a good human, man. I never met somebody in my entire life that had a nickname of Stab that I was like happy to see. You know what I mean? And that's the kind of stuff that MetaWorld needs. There's a class and a group within a group. And I am making it my life's mission to find the really good-natured people inside of MetaWorld. And I want to start stringing some storylines together, because doing stuff and doing content alongside you guys, man, it's a blessing. You guys are so much fun to do this with. That was a joke. Oh, you got me then. You got me. You got me. My man did 20 years and 23 23 motherfucking days. He counted all the way down to the last one. Yo, can we get a shout out for Stab in the chat, please? 20 years of this man's life. That's amazing. That's truly amazing, y'all. If you are older than 20 years old, that means that Stab has been sacrificing himself for longer than you've been alive. That's what that means. That's cool as fuck.
Up.
That's cool as fuck. I'm trying to use my beeper better. It doesn't always work because I have a foul mouth and I'm not trying to get banned. But no, that's cool, man. I'm sorry that I didn't get the joke. I was initially, when I read that, I'll tell you the truth, when I first saw that post, it was a while back that he made that post, so it's nothing recent, guys, but he put a post up. I think I was back still in DOC at the time, and I saw the post, and my first thought was, damn it. My first thought was, I was really upset because we finally had set up a good, like, kind of a good pasta at the prison, and I was bummed at the potential that he was going to be leaving. I mean, not that I could really say shit, because he's, you know, the way that I read the post is that he was going to be leaving MetaWorld and going back into the army. So I can't really say shit. I gotta give him his props for doing that. But yeah, I definitely did not see the joke in that. So my bad. apparently I just don't understand your sense of humor all the way yet. But I'm gonna make it my purpose to do some storylines with you, and get to know you a little bit better, so that I can unlock that sense of humor. But 20 years, man, that's serious. That's serious. That's a hell of a time commitment. My father, when he retired from the Marine Corps, he retired at 30 years and about a month. And it was hard watching him step down from that. I won't put too much of his stuff out there, but he retired as a colonel in the Marine Corps. He was a combat helicopter pilot, flew AH-1 Whiskey, and ultimately was one of the commanding officers that took over when the AH-1 Zulu, Cobra attack helicopter, when that came into service and was replacing the Whiskey model. He was actually the commanding officer down at Camp Pendleton. This is the same gentleman that just had a full liver transplant the day after Christmas, so... One of the many reasons why I've been bouncing back and forth in and out of the city, trying to get down to San Diego to spend some time with him and be with him. But yeah, it was intense to realize when I started doing the math of my childhood that he joined the Marine Corps before he had me. So effectively, the entire time that I was, you know, alive, I've known nothing but the Marine Corps. It's been, the military as a whole has been my entire life. So I have a lot of deep affinity and deep love for all things military, for all things service connected. Unfortunately, I had some health issues that prevented me from being able to join, and not for lack of trying, you know, unfortunately. Thankfully, and I say this slightly begrudgingly, because we got some people involved that some higher up, some folks in the Department of the Navy that were going to sign off on some waivers for me to get in, some pre-existing health conditions that I had from childhood that would not have affected my ability to do the job in any transferable way. It was a blood disease. But in the event that I got shot, in combat, there was a potential that I risked infecting my squad mates. And so for that reason, The U.S. Navy was never allowed to sign off on me. And that dramatically affected the course of my life because all throughout childhood, all I ever envisioned doing was being in the military. So when you're 18 years old and you finally graduate from high school and you're looking to join and they're basically telling you you can't, even with a waiver from the Department of Defense, we had the Secretary of the Navy get involved. We approached senators and congressmen to get their stuff to get me in. I mean, we fought like hell. It's the only thing I ever wanted in my life was to be just like my dad. So, yeah, that's one of the reasons why I have such a deep affinity. I know it's, and it's funny too, because depending on the veteran and the experience that they went through with their time in the military, everybody has kind of a different experience and a different takeaway from it, right? Because some people will tell you their time in the military was the best time of their life. Some people will tell you it was the worst time of their life. And neither one of them are wrong. And it really depends. So it always gets met with mixed feelings when I tell people, you know, all I ever wanted to do was be in the military. And I, even though I fit the classic profile of like the guy that almost joined, I really did go as far as I could trying to find a back door and a way in that on the surface I should have never been able to join. So that also explains why I continued in the civilian sector, why I have the job that I have now. And why I do some of the things that I do, being a bodyguard and a certified helicopter pilot. Both of those things I was expecting to have in the military, and I wasn't able to. So I had to go out and carve out those niches for myself. And that's kind of explaining a little bit about why I am the way that I am. I had to read all the way to the end of the post. Oh, so you're doing me twice, man. He's telling me it's a joke, and he's telling me I can't read good. He's telling me I can't read good. He's telling me I need to buy some stock in Hooked on Phonics. Don Joseph said, I finally made that spicy omelet this morning, and let me tell you, ooh-wee, it's fire. Listen, I will not steer you wrong, dude. I will not steer you wrong. Spicy omelets, it's the only way to eat omelets. You got to get that pepper jack cheese and diced up jalapenos, some bell peppers and stuff, man. And then get some salsa on top of it once you're all done. Oh, good Lord. It's the best. It's the absolute best. So I'm glad that you made that, man. I'm kind of impressed. Bud Dudley says, Bud met his nephew the other day, and he was so kind enough to take all the heavy armor and all the valuables off of him. Wife walked in for a quick sec, so I wanted to talk with her. Okay, getting back to the chat real quick. That's funny that Bud got taken for all of his gear. And, oh, here we go. Elite Pierre, I was medically retired due to PTSD. Honestly, I wanted to stay. I miss it, but I don't miss the time away from my family. You know what? There's a lot of people, understandably so, there's a lot of people that I work with currently. I am also, I have a civilian version of PTSD, clinically diagnosed and unfortunately hospitalized for as well. We'll get into that some other time. But where was I going with that? I'm sorry. A couple guys that have been on teams, tier one type stuff, and they all say the same thing. It's they equate it to like going to a circus. They miss the monkeys. They don't miss the circus, if that makes sense. It's a euphemism for, you know, you miss the people that you're embracing the suck with. You embrace the times with the people. It's the job itself. It's the circus itself that you don't miss. The army, the greater army, is something that you don't miss. But the people, the relationships, you know, some of the things that you did in a day-to-day sense, those seem to be the very common threads that I experience in my interactions with most veterans. And that's completely irrelevant. It's one of those things that seems to transcend whether you serve, you know, for a quick four or six, or if you do an entire career. It always seems to be the same thing. They don't miss the military proper. They miss the people and the relationships that they did it with. So I hope that I have kind of encapsulated what you were meaning in that way. But thank you very much. I appreciate the bravery that it took for you to say that out loud. So that's very cool. That's very, very cool. Very, very cool. Heard that was a dangerous neighborhood. Now I'd stay far away from Purple City if I was a cop. Oh, yeah. Far, far away. Far, far away. You guys are too funny. All right. All gassed up and nowhere to go. We have... I don't know where I can sell. I'll have to hold on to those gems for right now. How much money am I sitting on? Hold on a second. I need to shut this engine down. Advertisements. I need... How do I check the bank? Which one's the bank? Services? No. Crypto? No. Employment? No. Debit? No. This doesn't tell me. Oh, here we go. Oh, hey, I do have enough. All right, cool. So I can at least get a knife, and I can at least start doing some some farming stuffs. This is awesome. I appreciate you guys blowing chat up right now. Mike, Don, and Finn. T-Bank. Oh, think about bank. Yeah, see, this... I'm going to be really annoying. $600 in my pocket and $8,000 in the bank. I'm going to be a really annoying criminal because you guys are going to have to teach me how to do a lot of basic shit. But once I know how to do the basic shit, we can get on to doing the fun shit. So... Yeah, I'm broke. Man, shut your bitch ass up. You got to get in here and we got to meet so I can get a job, because right now I'm trying to do this. I have a helicopter and I'm trying to do criminal stuff, but I don't know any criminals, so it's pretty freaking hard to do criminal stuff and make criminal money if you ain't got none of both. I'm broke. That's pretty today. A little overcast. All right, let's go take care of a... let's see if we can get a little money out of the casino on that free spin. And that way, once I buy my knife, I'm not stuck without... I'm not stuck without any money, period. I'm gonna have to figure out a way to mitigate some of this stress too, because the stress of being a civilian and doing stuff is ridiculous. So I'm all ears for whenever you guys wanna tell me how to manage that. If it's a drug thing, if it's a pill thing, I don't know what specifically I need to be prepared for, but. I don't know if there's any cops in the city right now. There was 11 people total in the city when I very first flew in. I've been in for, I don't know, an hour or so. I can't imagine there's going to be a lot of people, if any. Go on. There it is. Yeah, cops get no stress. It's cool. It's cool if you're a cop. It's not cool if you're not a cop. Yeah, it's definitely not cool to be in a constant state of stress just for doing things like it. And that's the other thing too. I could see a very strong case made for if you steal a helicopter, it should stress you out to fly it. That makes sense. You're flying a stolen helicopter. That would stress anybody out. If I am flying the helicopter that I purchased with my own money, why would that stress me out? Does that make sense? I mean, why would I be stressed if I was flying my own helicopter legally? I don't, that doesn't make sense to me, even from an RP standpoint. Yeah, and that's, I'm sorry that that's breaking news for you, Stab, but if you have law enforcement roles, you never get stressed. So if you get into a shootout, if you are driving super fast, it's a zero factor for stress for police. I would say that's probably the largest perk. Yeah, probably the largest perk of being law enforcement is that you de-stress.
Are you ready for an unforgettable experience? The action is hot at our table games. Live life to the limit. Play around.
Is that like a speech they only give you the first time you come into the casino? I don't recall ever hearing that before. I heard there was money. What's this? A casino burger? Oh, somebody won a casino burger and didn't want it. All right, let's go. Let's spin it. Should we do a max spin?
Another player about three quarters. Lucky wheel. Will they win big or
the stress needs a lot of work. Cops should get double stress, honestly. That's a terrible idea. Finn, you shut your mouth. Don't give anybody that idea. Oh, please. Oh, give me 20. Hot damn. Hot damn. Yeah, buddy. That's a big win. We needed that.
How can I help you?
You can
Another
help me.
Day in Los Santos.
You can help me by giving me that attitude you give me every day.
There.
Yeah, that's the attitude. Thank you, sweetheart. Can't stand that computer person. She has very, very poor social skills. All right, so we got a little cheddar in our pocket. Helicopter's out back. We have... We need a knife. So that would be probably the next step here. Yeah, now only $10 million to go, no doubt. No doubt. I'll settle for $1 million house. So that's the immediate goal. Definitely going to be the immediate goal is get a house or I don't know. Maybe we'll see. But I'm toying with the idea of starting an org. But I'm toying with the idea of starting an org so that it can legitimize what we're doing and give us access to org stuff. So that's a potential. I'm not sold on the idea yet, to be quite honest. I don't know if it's something I want to stand up like an actual proper org or if we just want to do like an informal one, but ooh, this cough button is 2 for 2. I don't want to cough right into this microphone. All right. Let's see here. I need... a little bit of a mound right there. I need a weapon store between here and that's gonna have to be that one. I need a weapon store between here and the livestock fields. But that's Sandy Shores is definitely not where I want to be flying and landing. But yeah, so Stab and Finn, I'm going to need to connect with you guys in city at some point. I would, I'm not going to metagame, so I'm not going to set anything up with y'all, but I'm just going to put it out in the universe to put it out in the universe. I look forward to meeting both of your characters in city and introducing you guys to Lieutenant Dane Taylor. I'm not sure what kind of org it would be, and I don't know if I want to invest that much time into it, to be honest. If I start an org, I would have to effectively kill off my PD character, because if I'm going to invest time into an org, it's going to be my main storyline. And law enforcement for now still feels like my main storyline, even though I'm going to have a blast and I anticipate having a lot of fun with this particular character. Kyle Patrick, I still believe that Kyle Patrick's going to be my main focus for now. And that would be the reason why I would tentatively wait on an actual full-on orc. All right, I think the gun store is right down there.
Yep.
I think there's a compound around here too, if I'm not mistaken. But that's all right. We should be all right. I can come down and put this guy right here in the parking lot without issue. Perfect. That was a good little set down. I'm starting to learn bits and pieces of how this particular helicopter performs, and it is the best way that I could describe it. For those of you that don't fly, the metrics that I would use to describe how a helicopter flies, I'll use with like how a car drives. So if you've driven like oh, that's cool. I want a cannon. What the heck? There's all kinds of cool stuff in here. Yo. I just need a knife. $7,000. Good Lord. But yeah. So we'll see. The jury's still out. I haven't even really given it a chance to see what Lieutenant Dane can do. So, you know, there's elements of this that we have. We may be able to do everything we want to do without being an org, you know? Depending on what that looks like for my ideas and criminal enterprises and connections that we make. All right, coming into the pig farm here. shoot, a little bit of a realistic approach. Just set this big old girl right on down. He saw that cannon from up. He's like, squirrel. Yep, that's me. All right, Finn. I hope I see you in city at some point, brother. Thanks for stopping by the stream, man. All right, let's go ahead and... I'm doing my best Stab impression right now. Hey, Stab, how's it look? I don't know if he's still in the stream yet, but... Sorry, piggy, piggy. Here, pick, 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 pick. Here, pick, 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 pick. Nice. Pig skin, raw sausage, raw pork. They give you a lot. I appreciate, you know, like for, especially for the mining or the drilling rather, the drilling noises are so obnoxious. They're so loud. And if you, I mean, if you're going to be, I mean, back in like the early days of 2.0, I think when everybody came in, mining was a big thing. And it was just the auditory. Oh my God, it was so bad. You almost had to, you had to go into your 5M sub process and mute it. But I say all that to say, I'm glad there are no associated noises with having to do the unpleasant, because slaughtering a pig, I can't imagine, sounds...
Thanks for playing with us.
Pleasant.
Have a great day.
So, in that way, I'm glad that we don't have to listen to that, and I'm glad that I don't have to do a secondary thing where I go in and mute parts of this. So, we got Henny in the building. Welcome, Henny, and thank you for the stream like. BCT Gaming in the building. That's good people right there. It's cool. I appreciate you guys for coming in and checking out my stream. It's, I always get so much inspiration from watching other content creators in the city, because there's a lot that I don't know how to do. And, you know, as with anything, you seek out people that RP in similar fashions to yourself. And it's very cool to have a group of content creators that I actually look at with admiration. And BCTV, you are one of a few people in MetaWorld that I look at with a lot of admiration for the way that you RP, the diversity in your characters, the pasta that you and your characters create. I am in awe and enamored with the talent because I don't seem to have that yet. So as I figure out a way to craft and hone my skills and my talent, I am left impressed by others in the city that I do my digital life right alongside with. So giving roses where roses are due, but BCTV Gaming is a inspiration for a lot of the content that I drive out. So keep doing what you're doing. It's appreciated. Don't make you get emotional. Don't make it weird. Don't make it weird. No, I'm just a firm believer. There's a life, a kind of life philosophy that I that I subscribe to anyway. And people routinely will tell you all of the nicest things about you after you die. Right? Like, go to a funeral. Go to somebody's funeral and find somebody that's talking shit. Right? It never happens. Funerals are a time where you remember the best about a person. And unfortunately for many of us, during our life, during the time that we're actually alive, people don't, for reasons unknown, maybe it just socially feels weird or they don't want to look silly or be embarrassed or whatever, but for reasons unknown, the same amazing things that they would tell about a person at their funeral or at their bedside, if, you know, and I just experienced this with my own father. My dad and I were, we have a very complicated relationship. It's good some years, it's bad some years, it's estranged other years. But all of that changes when you see him, you know, you see somebody that you care about go through something serious in that way. So I was very fortunate that my dad and I left nothing unsaid, and we were in a great spot prior to him doing this procedure. But I'm a firm believer that you shouldn't wait until somebody's in a hospital bed or unfortunately in a casket to let them know what you think about them. So in kind of a, I'm going to break it down for real life kind of thing. I never waste an opportunity to tell people when they have an impact or an influence on my life. And, you know, RP is still something that's pretty new to me. You know, I do it because I enjoy it, not because I'm good at it or I make a living doing this. I do it because I enjoy it. And anything that you spend enough time doing, you know, eventually you're going to want to get better at it. And the only way that I've ever found to get better is to watch the people that are better than me with the mentality of accepting the fact that there are people that are better than me. And I'm okay with that. My my personality type allows for that space because I look at people, you know, like Elite Gaming, like Finn Human. Finn the Human, like BCTV Gaming. I look at these content creators that, you know, they are big in a sense that they're much bigger than me. But they are, oh no, did I sell all my apples? Oh shit. I didn't realize that he bought apples too. Damn. But I look at some of these content creators and I realize, you know, we can't all be the Townsends, we can't all be the Boogs, we can't all be She Ready Gaming, you know, we can't be the Show Me Gaming money, Commissioner Money. We are all aspiring to be content creators on that level, you know, but we're smaller. And the thing that I love is that, you know, these cities are made up of those small contents. You know, obviously we need the big content creators to drive the main storylines in the city and set the tone, but by and large, the city is really made with the people that make it up. And these are some of my favorites. So I just wanted to give you guys your roses, and that's all that is. Not trying to make it be emotional. Not trying to do anything with it. I firmly believe in telling people that they matter while they still have time to process and do something with that information. So you take that. You take away from that whatever you want. Okay. That's enough soapbox. Well, I suppose, why don't we go up here and we need to pick, we need to pick some fruit or some de-stress stuff. We'll go ahead and cruise out on the freeway here. I'll get low and fast. That way I don't have to go all the way over the mountains, but it's right around the tunnels here. You know what I do like, though? The one thing that I enjoy about this particular helicopter, the Frogger, is it has this really, like, kind of a guttural sound. You know, like how on some classic cars, like straight pipes, classic cars with straight exhaust pipes, they have that, like, you know, really good, just guttural kind of rumble to them. There's a couple of helicopters that, there's a couple, oh, I remember the point I was going to try and make at the, thing. This sounds like a good Huey. Like, it has a really good chop sound to it, which is where that, when people say chopper, which I can't stand, I hate that terminology, it's because it gives a really good chopping sound, and there's only a few aircraft that actually make that or produce that sound. The Huey being one of them, and I think this is, of all the aircraft that, well, yeah, there's another aircraft that I tried to purchase, but it's apparently a blacklist, so I'll just leave it there. And, yeah, it looks like it works. But I was talking to you guys about how certain aircraft fly, and if you're a non-pilot and you've never flown an aircraft, it'd be hard to, you know, compare the two. And so most of the aircraft that I fly, I would equate to like driving a four-cylinder Honda Civic, right? Like, it's a car, it drives, it's got enough power, but it's underpowered for most things. If I wanted to slam on the gas and really drive, you know, like a sports car, how much performance are you going to get out of a four-cylinder engine? You know, you can only expect so much. So if you have low expectations, you're going to have fun. That's most of the aircraft that I fly are going to fall into that category. And they perform very, they're very nimble helicopters. So it would be like a four-cylinder, but with the responsiveness of like a motorcycle. You know, like I could bend and wrap around corners, and you do a lot of performance-based stuff. Then you have aircraft like the one that I'm flying right now. It would be like driving kind of like a Cadillac Eldorado. You know, one of those cars that drives kind of more like a boat, if that terminology makes sense with you or lands with you. using the it's just, again, more engine power, like V6, V8, it's going to be more powerful, but that's not necessarily going to translate to performance, because I would still take a smaller helicopter that's more performance-based over a higher-powered helicopter that's less maneuverable. And so the helicopter that I'm currently flying, this one, has plenty of power, but it's not very maneuverable, and it flies like a boat. It drives like, I would imagine, a Cadillac Eldorado, you know, slow and sluggish controls, not fly-by-wire kind of stuff. So it just affects it in that way. The Super Valido, the helicopter that I have that my Kyle Patrick character plays in, that flies like a Ferrari in a sense that it has the power, the performance, and the flight handling that you would expect. And that is a blast to fly. But in the spirit of trying to keep both my characters very separate, I did not want them to share resources. And I didn't, more importantly, I didn't want people associating the Super Valido, my carbon helicopter, with criminal activity. I want this helicopter associated with criminal activity. So I made the decision to go in a different way. But if I have to be honest, and unfortunately I'm trying to be as honest as I can, this was my third pick for a helicopter. So, did the blacklisted heli happen to be the equivalent of an Apache? No, I haven't even seen that one. That's like the military. There's a military version of that, and it is based, well, it's based on a hybrid version of the Apache and the Comanche helicopters. The Comanche is like the kind of modernized, I'll put in air quotes, like stealth version of the Apache. It has an enclosed tail rotor system like this one.
Thanks for flying with us. Have a great day.
But yeah, that is not an option for you to actually purchase out of the actual airport. Elite Squad, thank you so much, sir. Stab in the building. But they have a Huey. They call it the Maverick. In this, in the Grand Theft Auto universe, they have what is basically a Huey. It's probably the probably the closest aircraft that looks exactly like a real one in real life. There's a few variations to it, but it's all, for all intents and purposes, it's a Huey. It's a UH-1 Huey. It was blacklisted, and that was my first pick. And then there was a small helicopter, which is actually based on the Little Bird, the UH-60 Little Bird, and that is also blacklisted. So this Frogger one, I pulled it up when I was purchasing it to kind of see if it was purchasable, if it was for sale. And how I found out that you could buy it is that I became the proud owner of it. Man, I tell you what. It is, it sucks being broke. That's for dang sure. Having 20K in your pocket's not, it's not going to get it done. That's not going to get it done. I see a cool truck over there. Green hot rod looking truck. Squirrel! Ooh, it's a hot rod. Oh, this is Lieutenant Dane's style. Ooh, this is Lieutenant Dane's style all day. Oh, wait, I can do stuff like this now because I'm a criminal. Well, this is fun. Shit, is that a cop? This is cool. Yeah, I'm for sure. We gotta do something with this. Oh, it's slow. What the hell? Dang, this thing is so slow. Oh man, this is a huge letdown. I promise you, I have it absolutely floored right now. Oh, it's really ass heavy too. Wow. This is a huge disappointment. This car looked amazing. And it's driving like the rust bucket that it unfortunately looks like it is. Just making sure there's nothing in it. All right. I need to unlock this. And then I need to... Let's see. We've got apples good. And I need an advanced lockpick. But I don't want to leave my helicopter. Like... anywhere around here. I'm gonna stash my helicopter somewhere. Because I'm up here by the recycle bin. The recycle center is up here. But, I want to put my helicopter somewhere where they're not going to find it, but I can still have access to it. And it needs to be hidden, obviously, but it can't be so hidden that I can't get in and out. I mean, we could probably just drop it right over there. Oh, they have a damn tree right in the middle of it. Shit, that's not going to work. All right, hold on. Oh, here we go. This will be a good spot. We just gotta find some level ground here. I can probably go right here. I can swing the ass end of this off. And I should be all right. Just pop it right there. Yeah, that'll work. Yeah, it works in a few spots. That's cool. That's very cool. Oh man, this gives me, this is fun because this is giving me ideas of places that we can stop and stage and set up, you know, like I was telling you earlier, set up switch spots. But even in here is so much more interesting because if I can get down deep enough into the trees, potentially there might be some concealment during a police chase if I'm being pursued. Very interesting stuff. Why don't we... Why don't we see what we can see? I feel comfortable. I have a knife, so I mean, that's... If Stab taught me anything, it's that if you have a knife, it's at least a fair fight. What are these things, though? In other cities or in Grand Theft Auto, I've never played through the campaign, and this has never worked in our city. But what are these things? Are these missile silos? Do these open? Can you do stuff with them? Like, these look like hinges that would open if there was like a script for it, but I've never known what it is, and I've always been curious, especially as a helicopter guy, because these always appear as, in my eyes, like my brain will see that and go, oh, perfect. That's a helipad. But every time that I try to, any time that I've tried to land on them, it causes a lot of issue for me. So I stop landing on them, even though they're great spots. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over to the recycle center. And the reason I'm going to the recycle center is I want an advanced lockpick. And I'm hopeful that I can get some crypto sticks as a different way to make some extra money. They are underground warehouses. Is it? This is not metagaming because I'll never do anything with this, at least for the foreseeable future. But do we have access to those in MetaWorld, or is this like a city by city thing, and we don't support that at the moment? I don't know how to ask that question correctly, but does MetaWorld have access to them? My thinking is no, but you know, just curious. Thank you for that, Alex. I appreciate the knowledge that you're dropping on the stream today. All right, let's see what we got. All right, we have the place to ourselves. All right, we need... We need to figure out how much it takes for us to craft our stuff. And I'm going to need an electronics kit because I need an advanced lockpick. So I need 30, 45, and 28. Thirty metal scrap, 45 plastic, and 28 aluminium. It's not four cities, it's only for the Grand... Okay, I got you. Okay, gotcha, gotcha. Yeah, I would have to imagine there's stuff in the city that pertains to the actual storyline, the main storyline of the campaign, but... you know, may or may not have anything to do with any of the online stuff. I can see that. Appreciate the knowledge again. See what we're working with here. We need to get all of my supplies and stuff.
Thanks for flying with us. Have a great day.
No idea why I'm still holding on to these. Okay, so I have a toolkit. I have metal scrap, which is good. And I have steel, which is good. Thank you, Alex, for the stream like. And glass. Plastic, copper, and metal scrap. All right. Cool. This will just help me keep an eye on what I'm working with here. Yeah, I don't even know where the drug spots are, man. Find all the drug spots because I can't keep doing this. There's no point in being a criminal if I got to do all this stuff by the right. You know what I mean? I'm trying to sell those drugs. Just got to know where they are. I got to meet some people that are willing to show me some stuff because I don't want to do this. I don't want to have to craft all my basic stuff. If anyone's going to find him, it's a guy with a helicopter. I hate you, Don. Don't do that. Yeah, but then the other part of that coin is just because I have a helicopter, now I have to go look for shit. And I could either go explore this entire city looking for needles in haystacks, a needle in a stack of needles, basically. Or I could develop the kind of relationships where people cut the work in half and... I trade helicopter services for a ride out to the drug spots. You know what I mean? Why drive there and risk getting pulled over when you could get dropped off, fly under the radar, no pun intended, and call for pickup when you're ready to leave and show me a helicopter, Show me any policy in any of the police departments that allow you to initiate a helicopter traffic stop. Right? Show me how they enforce speeding in a helicopter. So right then and there, I've eliminated probable cause, reasonable suspicion. I'm combating that openly by creating a problem they don't have an answer to. I would have to be on the ground, physically landed on the ground in a space where they would prevent me from taking back off in order for them to even have a card in their pocket to play. You know what I mean? You can't fly up alongside of me and pull me over. You can't fly up alongside of me and pit me without destroying your helicopter. So it's a suicide mission at that point. So you're telling me that if I commit a felony, you're going to risk the life of a deputized officer to crash into me to kill me? No, it's not going to happen. And so for that reason, there's going to be, I don't want to say like an immunity to it, but there's going to be a freedom to it that the city is just not, I don't know if anybody's really experienced this before. You know, what would you do if you could get to and from different parts of the city quickly, anonymously, and without any risk, direct risk to getting pulled over? I don't know. To me, that seems like we're in a whole new class of criminal, because this is going to go far beyond, you know, and just think of it in terms of like a drug operation. You know, let's say that there was a group of people selling drugs. I could pick you up and drop you off at different parts. Like, you sell drugs in one area for 5 or 6 minutes. I pick you up, drop you off somewhere else. You sell drugs for a few minutes, pick you up, drop, and you're just moving all over the map. PD's never going to be able to figure out where you're at, you know, or where you're going to go next based on, well, he was here, he might stay in this area, or, you know, you could be in, you know, Vinewood, and then 2 minutes later, there's a drug sale going off in Paleto, and the cops are like, well, how the fuck did he get all the way, he or she get all the way up from, you know, there to there in 2 minutes? And so either they're going to, you know, split resources to go look in the Vinewood area, you know, either way, diversifying, splitting up resources is the only way that criminals are going to get ahead in more of that way in the city. If you have, you know, 15 cops behind you in a chase, you fucked up. You know, you gotta split resources down to where you have manageable numbers of responding cops, to where if I get out of the car and I start shooting, I don't want 20 cops. I want one or two, you know? And so how do we do that? We have to get organized, and, you know, in a real sense, the org, you know, platform kind of provides that. But even in an unofficial way, you know, having relationships with different entities and groups within the city, you know, I would love to see, you know, traps getting hit at the same time the bank is getting robbed, at the same time that, you know, three different cliques are out selling drugs. And I would love to see what PD does in response to that. J.D. Sneed to the principal's office, please. And so that's what I mean. Like, it's, you know, if we could overwhelm the resources of law enforcement, spread them so thin, you know, it's sure not everybody's going to get away, but there's a lot of people that are going to make money. And so for the people that get caught, you know, it's kind of like pooling your tips at the end of the night. You know, you get all the crews that were out there selling, all the crews that were out there robbing banks, and for the people that created the distraction, they get a cut too. You know, and we pull together the stuff, and everybody gets a payout. And that way, you know, it's not going to be $1 million heist every single day. But if you're cranking out, you know, $400,000-$600,000, you know, per shift, and you're able to split that stuff, you know, that's, we're going to force PD to restructure in a way that they're going to have to be creative to figure out ways to stop us. And from what I've seen from the pilots that are in this city, it ain't there. So there's a huge vacuum right now of a capability that I, as my criminal character, I'm going to try and exploit. So we'll see what happens. I got to drink some water. All right, I have enough metal scrap. That's good. I need plastic, which I have about half of, and aluminum, which I have enough aluminum. Okay, so that's good. So I have metal scrap and aluminum, and I need about double the plastic. And I haven't come across any Bitcoin yet. I love Bitcoin, though. I love doing that. The puzzle, it's fascinating to me. It kind of reminds me, it takes me back to like elementary school. We had these, it was weird. They had like these books. I can't find them that much anymore. I was telling my, I have two sons and I was telling my sons about them. But do you remember those books that like they had the magic, they called like the magic eye or something like that, where you hold the book really close to your face and then you cross your eyes and then you have to like slowly pull the book away from your face and it reveals some like three-dimensional image on the paper. Kind of like that. But yeah, it's kind of like how you used to have to look at those. You know, it was like an acquired skill. You would hold the book right up to your face, and I feel like some certain people weren't able to get it all the time. Like some people did. And then it was like once you had the skill, then you could look at any page in the book and be able to do it. That's kind of like what my experience with crypto was in City. Because when I first started doing it, I was looking at it. And I'm like, I don't understand this. I don't understand how you're supposed to. I mean, it looks like matrix code. It's just top to bottom vertical matrix code. And you're supposed to find, of all the numbers that are constantly changing, you're supposed to find a row of numbers that are static. And then in a certain time period, which, you know, they have to induce like added stress, they have a countdown clock timer thingy and a beep. So you see, you physically, visually, you see the timer counting down, and then it has this auditory beeping noise. So it's like boop, boop, boop. And it's constantly making you feel like, oh shit, you're running out of time. You're fucking up. You're fucking up. You're not doing it. And it's supposed to create like a little bit of stress and panic for you. The first like two or three times that I tried to do it, I couldn't do it. And I got really frustrated. And then it was like, I tried it a fourth time and it clicked in a way that like now when I do crypto, I just see it. And I don't, it's weird. So if I'm able to find crypto doing stuff like this, which I don't think I've even found a stick of it yet. And that's probably because crypto's up right now. It looks like it's rebounding. At one point, crypto was at like $4,000. My Kyle Patrick character could have made a couple hundred thousand dollars if I would have sold all the crypto that I was holding on to. But I feel like maybe because crypto's a bit higher right now or it's on the way up, maybe they nerfed how much crypto is going to show up when you're doing the recycle, but we'll see. Oop. All right, let's see. Oop. I just clicked out of my phone. I had my phone open to my crafting notes. 45 plastic, so I need to check and see. I have 28, 45 glass. Oh, I'm in the wrong. I have the wrong materials for what I need. Yeah, they're not going to know about it for a while. And I think, you know, that's kind of, it'll be fun for a little while because for a period of time, we're going to exploit a pretty big vacuum and they're not going to know what to do with it. So that's going to be fun. When they eventually do figure out what to do with it, it's going to be fun all over again because now it's going to be, you know, GG's. It's going to be, you know, I may get away sometime. I may not get away sometime. I know in the beginning, I'm going to get away every time. So I'm not saying that. I know that sounds really arrogant. I apologize for how arrogant it sounds, but like there's going to be an evolution to this. And the evolution is going to be we and or I am going to get away with murder, quite literally, up until I don't. And PD is going to have to come up with a response. Now, this is advantageous for a couple of reasons. And I was just thinking about this morning. I got up super early this morning. It was about 4 o'clock this morning. I was awake and I was thinking about right now from an Air One standpoint, from a law enforcement standpoint, there's not a real need to have a really qualified like Air One pilot in the city. you know, like beyond doing like scene supervision or aerial coverage of something going on, law enforcement wise, beyond doing that, beyond, you know, finding or tracking a suspect that goes out into the woods, beyond doing that stuff, there's not a air to air need for Air One right now. Maybe Lieutenant Dan creates that. You know what I mean? Me coming in as my criminal character and doing a lot of air stuff, I think, in theory, is going to help drive the point home and create a narrative within law enforcement to either fully establish Air One, reestablish Air One, or make Air One an otherwise larger functioning piece of law enforcement. How are we going to do that without a really capable criminal pilot that is kind of clowning on PD? You know what I mean? Like, it, my narrative as a criminal is actually going to help progress my career in law enforcement, even though Lieutenant Dane and Kyle Patrick will never be chasing each other. Just the lore, the backstory of Lieutenant Dane existing is going to give Kyle Patrick a reason to get up in the air even more, even though Kyle Patrick and Lieutenant Dane will never actually square off. So, just a thought. Scotty Marshall, what's good with you, my guy? I hope your day is great. My day is not going great, but I'm trying to polish a turd, as they say. So, excuse me while I stand here with my Windex and my microfiber cloth, and I polish the shit out of this shit. I've been finding that's a common theme for me last couple weeks. Trying to make do. Trying to push through harder days, emotional days.
Thanks for playing with us. Have a great day.
I appreciate that. Thank you so much for the like. Your name has not popped up yet, but I will send you to the principal's office very quickly here. Napster. Napster to the principal's office, please, although I feel like you might already know the way. You'll never catch the real... Wait, hold on. I'm sorry. I don't know if you'll find that as funny as I did, but... That's an Ocean's 11 joke there, reference for you. Napster, that's old. Yeah, I'm old. No, you want to know old? You want to know old? Hey, when was the last time you guys listened to anything from LimeWire? When was the last time you listened to a CD that you burned with music that you download, dialed up? You dial up, downloaded, and burned onto a CD via LimeWire. Then come talk to me about old. Scotty says he is project planning, getting ready to do some surveying and smart tool running in a 36-inch pipeline for roughly 50 miles. Damn. That's cool, man. I'm like weirdly fascinated. That's really interesting. Part of my consulting company, I run a consultancy. I'm not going to plug my consultancy right now, but I will just say for now, for the namesake, I run a consultancy, and I have three divisions of my company. One is security, one is aviation, and one is technology. And in the overlap of my technology and aviation Venn diagram, I'm actually a certified drone pilot, and I actually really love to fly drones. But I do surveying and stuff for the electrical grid. So I've never actually worked with underground pipes or anything being laid either underground or above ground. But as the there were some issues here in California with the wildfires up north. PG&E, SDG&E, and a few of the electrical companies, Edison, have commissioned a lot of drone pilots and surveyors to go into some of the remote parts of California and use drones to survey some of the power lines to make sure that there's not encroachments into the tree lines and creating fire hazards. So that's been my only experience with surveyors, and it is fascinating to me. It really is. Like, I would, if I could go back and do a second type of career, drafting, architectural engineering, engineering in general is very fascinating to me. I have kind of an engineer's brain. But yeah, that's really fascinating stuff, man. 50 miles of pipe. That's 36 inches in diameter. That's big. That's a 3-foot pipe. A 3-foot pipe for 50 miles. Think about that. That's crazy. That's halfway between LA and freaking San Diego. Wow. So I'm curious. Now you've hit my curious bone. What kind of stuff do you do? Like, what is the, if you can say, and obviously I don't want to get anybody in trouble. If you have like OPSEC stuff that you can't talk about at work, don't put that shit in my stream, because I don't want to get you in trouble. But what kind of stuff does it transport? Is it a 36 inches is fairly large, so I would imagine that's probably fluid, maybe not natural gas, probably oil or something of that. So it's actually 150 miles. Holy shit. Funny enough, I've been inside of a 96-inch aqualine in San Diego for 2 miles for roughly 2 miles at roughly 115 feet underground. 96? 12, 24, 36, 48. Dang, so that's big enough to walk in. I mean, 96 inches, that's shit. 72 is what, 6 feet? So yeah, you're 7-8 feet? Wow. That's quick math right there. That's crazy big. Like a 7 or 8 foot tall tunnel for 2 miles at 100 feet below ground? That's wild. And you guys, I mean, literally, you guys say that I have an interesting job being a bodyguard. Like, tell me what's more, that, I don't know. I guess the grass is always greener. That's interesting as fuck to me. Oh, whoops. Yeah, that's really interesting to me. Don remembers the LimeWire days. Good man. You know what's funny? There's a content creator that I follow on Instagram. My wife actually was the one that showed her to me originally. She's a Asian woman that lives here in Southern California, not far from us actually. And she was doing a stand-up, well, like a little skit rather, but she was doing a skit about LimeWire and the CDs that you used to be able to burn and do back in the day. And it kind of unlocked a weird core memory for me that I forgot existed. You know, it was like back in the recesses of your brain, when you would download the LimeWire CDs, and then people would put their like their little thing over it, like, you know, one time beats, you know, or something like that. It was like a digital watermark, like an audio watermark that people would put on there to let you know that they were the ones that either you downloaded the song from, or they were the ones that put some of the remix into it. But I always remember, like, you know, you would download a certain LimeWire song and it was kind of a crapshoot, like bastardized version of it with some random person speaking and yelling over in their mic. One-time productions. This is a one-time production. And then it like replays over and over again. Super annoying. So Scotty says, I pig, is that a word? Is that an industry term? Oh, I got a crypto stick. Sweet. I pig pipelines for cleaning. Mapping dents, dings, cracks, stress cracks. The particular line flows gas, diesel number 2, jet fuel, and some other gas on lean products. Interesting. So let's do some math here. Oh no, the San Diego thing was something different. Okay. So I'm not gonna assume that you're in San Diego. This project that you're planning for right now is probably not in San Diego. But you do this all over the US and Canada and sometimes in Alaska. Yeah, that makes sense to me. PIG stands for, oh, it is an industry term. PIG stands for the pipeline inspection gauge. Pipeline inspection gauge, PIG for short. Cool. Wow, learned something new today. Thank you for that. And everybody that was in chat today just learned something new. That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. I love it. Pipeline inspection gauge. So are you, which stage of that are you in? Like, are you in the part where the pipe has already been like put in ground and or above ground, depending on, you know, what the setup is? Are you there to go in there retroactively and inspect it, like you said, for deficiencies? Or are you involved in the laying of the pipe? I'm sorry, that was a terrible dad joke. No, but are you in the initial construction phase, or are you just in the repair, maintenance, and otherwise fixing of other people's problems? Scotty says he hates to be away from home, but the money's good. My God, dude. If there is ever a statement that I have understood in my soul, man, you and I share that in common. The money that I make bodyguarding is incredible, especially when I travel. We are, our earning potential when we travel with clients is substantially higher. I got 2 crypto sticks. Awesome. I got a lot of rubber and a lot of iron, but I need plastic and I have enough. Perfect. Let's get out of here. But yeah, being away from family is really hard. And every time that I travel away from my family, it feels like, you know, there's this old phrase from back in the day where you can't sell your car for gas money. You can't get rid of one thing to fix another problem. And the time that you spend away from your family is always very difficult. Like, very difficult. And when you're spending time away from your family to also provide for your family, it's like it stands in conflict. Like those Well, I'm not streaming. Oh, I am streaming. Just kidding. All right. I'm like, I'm not streaming. No, I am streaming, you dumbass. Here's your sign. So Scotty says, so let's just finish that thought real quick before I get back to Scotty's comment. Yeah, the weird thing about being away from your family to provide for your family is just, it's a struggle. I think it's a struggle that we all face, and it's one of those things that I don't think anybody's really immune to it. You know, some of us have the ability to be home, but may not be, you know, the type of provider that we'd like to be. Some of us are providers in all the ways that we would like to be, but time at home is the precious commodity that we sacrifice. And so there's a constant battle, I think, in most of us, that we are somewhere between, you know, trying to do enough to get by and also managing to spend the time that we have when we're home. And that's a challenge, I think, that everybody truly faces. So, you know, for me, I have to balance between, like, the New York trip we were talking earlier in the stream, the New York trip that I went on, I was downrange for 2 weeks, and I was 24 hours a day on, which is amazing because then when I come back, I can take, you know, 2 to 3 weeks off and be completely home and present. And financially, we can make that work. And that's where it's incumbent upon me to take advantage of the time that I do have at home, try and make the most of it. But unfortunately, when duty calls, I'm not going to have the same ability to provide the way that I can outside the house. So it's really is a catch-22. But I definitely identify with that statement. Hate being away from home, but the money is good. And Scotty goes on to say, yeah, the pipe has been in the ground. We go and inspect them every 7 years by federal government. Okay. We sometimes do line commission and line decommission. Depends mainly. But we run them to make sure that they are clean and they don't have a lot of metal loose in them. Oh, interesting. Okay. So it's preventative. Every 7 years or so, you guys, you know, check the pipes, as it were. Although nobody mentioned... I made a really bad dad joke about laying pipe, and nobody got that, so I'm a little upset and offended. All right. We have crypto sticks, which is good, but I can't land my helicopter in that neighborhood. I'm not going to land my helicopter in that neighborhood, so... Let us go craft our advanced lockpick, which we can do at this small little airport here. That's a craft table I like to use. All right, start her up. That's fascinating stuff, man. Scotty Marshall. Keeping America literally. This man is keeping America running. One of those pipes breaks? Oof. Can you imagine? All right, I am literally on the backside of the tallest mountain, Mount C. So I'm gonna go around eastbound. The eastbound side of this mountain and come into where I need to land. Scotty says he 100% understands that. I think I was maybe home for a total of 3 months last year. Wow, so this man is out. He is life on the road for sure. That's a hard life, bro. I don't know how you do it. I have to really balance my time home, especially now. My kids are just getting to an age where things are starting to get fun. 5 and 6 years old, respectively. And I feel like when I miss time away from home, I'm missing milestones too. And it's hard coming back and seeing, like, oh, cool, you can do this now. Oh, cool, you can do that now. Like, I'm sad that I missed that, you know? So it's tough. It's a really, it's a tough balance because now they're, like, when they were young, when they were babies and stuff, you know, there's a lot of stuff I know they're not going to remember and memories they're not going to necessarily take with them. But as I get older now, it becomes the challenge, the balance, the delicate balance of being a dad is, you know, I want to be here every single day physically to be here, to have that time with them. But if I'm here at home all day, every day, I can't really make a living. And that's real too. I think I have all that stuff on me still. So let's see what we got. I need to craft an item. Alright, I need an electronics kit. This one. Got one. Alright. Let's see. Okay, okay. Wait, is it an electronic one? Or is it a toolkit? Why do I not remember how to make these? Shit. Damn it. I don't remember how to do this, you guys. I'm sorry. I'm struggling. It was a lockpick, and I thought it was an electronics kit. It can't be. Is it two electronics kits? I don't have enough stuff for that. So I have... Huh. What's up, JD? Yes, this is the first and only criminal character I've ever had in MetaWorld. So yeah, this is definitely a first for me. Oh, it's toolkit and lockpick. So I want to combine. Let's see if that worked. It worked. Awesome. Thank you so much. Shout out JD in the chat, please, for helping me. Yes, this is my criminal character. Scotty says, tell me about it. I have four kids. My 14-year-old plays competitive travel softball and league softball. My 13-year-old plays soccer. Shout out soccer. My 7-year-old plays baseball in the spring and soccer in the fall. And then we have a 3-year-old... and my wife is on both boards for softball, baseball, and the soccer board, and 90% of the time I'm gone. She also works a full-time job. Damn, Scotty. If I didn't have any respect for you before, which I already did, I'm certainly going to have a lot more for you now. Holy crap. That's craziness that you guys make all that work. I'm so impressed. That's not an easy life to manage, so my hat's off to you. Four kids, you're on your grind, your wife is on her grind, you guys are making it work. I respect it. May have to continue watching on the other side. That's okay. Your phone's dying and no charger. Well, you get the sad trombone. All right, so an electronics kit was not what I needed, apparently. So that's cool. But I have some advanced lockpicks, which is nice. And I have a regular lockpick, which is cool. All right. I feel good about that. Yeah, shout out to Scotty indeed. And Scotty, listen, I'm going to break some shit down for you, bro. For every guy that is married, the secret to any of us having respectable and normal lives is the women that we chose to marry. I firmly believe that. I don't know how my life works, and I can honestly say it probably would not if I didn't have my wife, who is actually, as we speak, she's picking up both my kids from school right now. I had drop-off this morning, and she knew that I was streaming, so she came in and asked me if, she goes, hey, do you want me to go pick them up? And I was like, yeah, that'd be perfect. And I didn't have to leave as quickly as I normally would have. So every now and then, man, it's really cool when you guys have to come together and do it. My wife works a full-time job. I work a full-time job. I own my own business as a consultancy on the side, and I do this. So it's finding time to do everything. You really need to lean into your partnership. And it's cool. When it works, and it works well, it's a really, really cool thing. Finn, take it back. Take it back, Finn. What, Scotty doesn't know? That's actually really funny. That's a reference I don't think a lot of people... Well, I don't know, maybe I don't... Maybe I'm probably speaking for people, but... That's a reference I don't think that a lot of people would get, but that made me laugh, so. Awesome. Wait, question before I switch over. Do I have an awesome dad van? Fuck no, I don't have a dad van. I have a... I think we've talked about this in the stream before. I have a Tacoma. I have a Toyota Tacoma. It's lifted and it has a camper shell on the back and it's got a rooftop tent. It's overland. It's all overlanded out. That's my dad mobile. Scotty doesn't know. Take it back, Finn. Take it back, Finn. Hey, Finn, when do I get to meet you in the city, bro? When's that gonna happen? Here's my police officer's house right here. Right there with the yellow. It's aight. I'm going to have to figure out at some point where I'm going to stash all my stuff. I mean, I guess I could just have to use the apartment for now, but... Have I looked at Twitter or Twatter or whatever it's called? No. Oh, you like all over Twitter. Finn the Human. Who's driving that big ass red truck? Oh, wow. I really gotta... That's crazy. I never check Twitter. So that's a first for me. That would be how I would figure out how to meet you. So asked and answered, sir. I wonder if I can set this thing down without looking at the skids. All right, I'm gonna shoot for the yellow one. Oh, easy does it. I'm a little behind it. A little behind it. All right, let's a little bit forward. Whoa. Easy, easy, easy. There we go. All right, let's see how we did. In the cockpit, without looking at the skids, how'd we do? That's not bad. I mean, I'd fix it a little bit, but that's not bad. That's not bad at all. All right, let's see if we can do Let's get a flight from here to the airport. Landing at the helipads, all inside. See if we can do this without dying. All right, we'll pick up into a hover. Bravo 26. Oh, wait, hold on. I got a voice mod I can use now.
Bravo 2612. We have information. November. Pick you up looking for a southbound departure. Bravo 2612.
Little squirrely when you're flying inside the cockpit, though. You definitely feel a lot more of the... Oh, you get some of the gauges work, so I guess it won't be helpful for me to look inside. All right, eyes outside. God, I love flying. There's just nothing like it, man. All right, we're over the airport now. We're going to come in. I'm just... There's those helipads right down there to the left. We're going to shoot for... let's shoot for number two. Go ahead and roll it. Arrest our forward flight a little bit. Start taking away. Just gonna float it a little bit more forward. We're still a little high. Try to center us up a little bit, and we'll just gently, ever so gently, come on down. All right, let's check our positioning. Oh, that's better. That's much better. So I seem to have an issue with my length out the back. I'm not accounting for how much longer this helicopter really is. So in terms of placing myself, I think it would be better for me to place probably near the front H a little bit. Do I have a local flying over me now? Yeah, I do. Okay, and so... Man, I'm kind of... That was kind of fun. I wasn't expecting that to, like, work. Finn said that this was a conversation where he almost died. So, who's got the information? I was spidering. Who's Barry White? Got me typing weird. I got a concussion now. Give me a ride to the hospital. You knocked me off my Sanchez. Oh, so somebody hit you. Oh, so who's driving that big... Okay. Who's driving that big-ass red truck? Me. Why? What happened? You knocked me off my Sanchez. About flew off the bridge. Give me a ride to the hospital. Give me a ride to the hospital. Got me typing weird. I got a concussion. he was at the casino. Okay, cool. All right, I'm going to have to figure out an organic way to meet you. Figure it out. I will figure it out. Probably won't be today, though. That's funny, though. All right. Let's see how we holding up. Okay on the waters. It's not a very luxurious helicopter, but it gets the job done. All right. And we're going to do a left pedal turn here. I'm going to try and find our taxi line here, since we don't really have one. I don't have a taxi, so we're just going to go ahead and I'm going to side slide us here. And then we're just going to nose it on forward. I'm in a really low hover taxi right now. Just a few feet off the ground. And I'm looking for this yellow line on the bottom here. This is my taxi line. And what it's telling me right there on the ground, you can see 33R and 12 left. And it's very intuitive. If you understand how a airport is laid out, these are basically like the street signs. You know, take a left on Euclid, go up to Mountain, take a left on San Antonio, that kind of stuff. This is telling me that if I want to be facing 33 left, or I'm sorry, 33 right, I'll take the left taxi. If I want to go to runway 12 left, I'll take the right taxi. And so for the direction of travel that we're going to be going, I want to be traveling that way. So I want to be going eastbound. So I'm going to push for 12 left, and then I'm going to look for an eastbound departure. So I'm going to push forward here, and I'm going to follow. I'm going to follow this here. I wish you guys knew how much harder it is. This is actually a lot more enjoyable. Flying the helicopter outside is getting kind of boring for me. So this is quite a bit harder, which is fun. More challenging, I should say. All right, we're going to be taking runway 12 left via taxiway Bravo 4. See that? So what I'm on right now is a taxiway. And I'm about ready to take the airport. But if you look down at the bottom there, you see there's two broken hash lines and two solid yellow lines. And you can think about those in terms of me crossing from here where I'm at onto that side. I'm going across broken double yellow lines. So that means that I need to hold short here and get my clearance from the air traffic controller, which, if memory serves, the ATC tower is what, behind us somewhere? I think it's somewhere over here. Anyway, so I would, in this case, if I'm not taking off directly from the helipad, then what I would do is I would come to this holding place in a hover, just like this, and I would request access to the runway. And the air traffic controller would confirm that there was not a jet or other aircraft coming on approach. They would also confirm that there's not a aircraft that's looking for a departure, and then I would be given my clearance to taxi. So we'll go ahead and taxi forward.
Bravo 2612 requesting take runway 12 left. We have information to take. And I'll
turn off my voice. And we'll take the middle of the runway. I'll go ahead and make a left pedal turn here. Go ahead and center ourselves up. And once we have center line, we're going to be looking at a couple things. We're going to be looking at our engine heat, our oil pressure. We're going to be making sure that all of our engine components are looking good just before we input some power. And when we're satisfied with how the engine is performing and we like all the gauges in our green, unfortunately, I'm not getting all of that feedback right now, but when we have all the gauges in the green and we feel satisfied with where we're at, then we go ahead and nose forward, increase a little bit of power, and what that's doing is we're pushing through what's called ETL, which is effective transitional lift, and it's what a helicopter does to stop hovering in one place and introduce forward flight. It's a transitory space that the helicopter has to navigate. Because once I'm flying forward, the all of the factors that influence how the helicopter flies are different when I'm flying versus when I'm in a static hover. All right, so since we're doing this by the book, I'm going to come into the cockpit here. We're going to go ahead and line up on our approach. And despite what most people think about helicopters, very rarely do you actually land straight down. More oftentimes than not, you would set these landings up, not all that dissimilar from how an aircraft pilot, a fixed-wing pilot rather, would set up their approach to a longer runway. The only difference is I don't have half a mile or a mile long runway to arrest my forward flight. So I will pick that yellow spot. I'm actually looking at the little black spot that is on the end of the H. It's like an oil drip. You can see that. That's the part that I am referencing right now. And I'm trying to keep that right in a like target spot in my eye, so that I know if I'm high or low or if I'm on my glide slope or not. Now, because of the problems that we were just experiencing, I'm gonna come ahead and, or go ahead and scoot a little bit more forward. I'm gonna bring the front of the cockpit to the bit of the circle and account for room on my tail. And let's see how we did. Much better, much better. And so that's what I was looking at. If you can see the oil slick there, that was the part that I was looking at from inside the cockpit. You see how it's now completely covered? That's how I sight that picture. So I'm looking at the oil slick, and as I'm coming in, I'm checking the oil slick, the spot. I'm checking that against the horizon. If I'm coming in too steep, that oil slick is gonna start rising in my sight picture. It's called a sight picture. If the oil slick is rising, that means that I'm sinking too fast. If the oil spot is dropping, that means that I'm rising too high. And if the oil slick is approaching me too quickly, it means that I need to slow down. So it's a metric that you can use to kind of keep track of where you are and how you fly. I have absolutely no idea why I'm giving you guys an aviation lesson right now, but for reasons unknown, I guess I feel like maybe you guys would enjoy it. And I'm just selfishly enjoying getting a chance to fly around in cockpit mode, so. All right, I'm gonna try and land on the US Bank building, which is the highest building in Los Angeles. It's gonna be right off our 12 o'clock here. And we're gonna, which is understandably. And everything looks good so far. I'm a little low, so I'm gonna pull up a little bit, grab a little bit of altitude here. Forward speed's looking good. We're slowing down. 19, 18, 17, 16. I like all of this. All right, sight picture is going to be that red light at the very, very end of our area here. And I'm just going to slowly take away a little bit of altitude, arrest a little bit of forward flight. Just gonna scooch it a little bit forward. Just nose it up, nose it up, nose it up. I like it. I think we're dead center. Hell yeah, look at that. I'm just saying, y'all. I see a local helicopter down there. Two local helicopters down there. Is that a local? Based on the way it's flying. Tough to say. Let's go find out. Well, it appears that must have been a local too. Yeah, it's a lot easier to fly this thing when you can see the entire aircraft, obviously. So here's USC, or what is that? Is that a house? Is that somebody's house? Oh, no way. Is that... Hold on. Did they make the Playboy Mansion? Have I just never... I don't think I've ever actually come down here to look at this. Hold on. Does the Playboy Mansion have a helicopter landing pad? No, they sure don't. But that's okay. I have on good authority that a helicopter may or may not have been landed at the mansion. Alright, I just play those noises for the trap. I don't want the noise. The trailer park trap. Oh, there's plenty of room to land here. Yeah, plenty of room here. Wow. Now, this is where we'd have to have a party. Is this somebody's actual house? Oh, crap. Is this somebody's actual house? I'm going to check the doors. If they're, like, locked, then I think it's actually somebody's house. Oh, crap. This is someone's house. Wow. Okay. Well, you have a nice pool, and your house is great. Bye. Oh, look at that. They even got the grotto and everything. No way. Well, this is cool. Music's terrible, but can't please everyone, I know. Wow, I didn't realize this was somebody's house. That's wild. All right, let's quickly get out of here. I apologize if anybody's catching the stream later and happens to see me land in your house. I apologize. I didn't know that was a house you could buy. I thought that was just a location type thing. I was curious to see this school here. This is the Getty Museum. It's a very underutilized part of the city. Huge building with all these areas, but not really used for anything. All right, I suppose I could do these two crypto sticks real quick, and I don't know. I guess I'll call it a stream for now. I know I'm going to have to come in at some point a little bit later, but let's see here. All right. I gotta go over to where the cryptos are. And we'll see what kind of money we can make. To find a place where I can land this, because my understanding is it's a neighborhood, which isn't going to be it's not going to be a great spot for me to try and find a spot to put down, but maybe in the dirt behind it. This is the street that I'm looking for right here. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to hide this away from everything. But I'm going to need a car to get down there. Weird. I keep getting confirmations that the helicopter shuts down, like the engine shuts down, but for some reason it keeps spinning. I mean, the door. So Don, when you say I don't think anybody lives there, the doors would not be locked if that was open. It might be an org house. If it's not somebody's, like, personal. Is there really not a vehicle that you can, like, steal in here? Wow, I was not expecting that. Here in the myriad of oil fields. Get up. You're fine. Now, Lieutenant Dane's got a little, got some issues with his legs being new and all. I was running. Man, I don't know what's going on with my signal lately. I apologize for that, y'all. I don't know if this is like a Facebook thing, but thank you. so much better. So much better.
I really appreciate how you reach out to the gay community.
Oh, this car has like... Oh, come on, car. I got all four cylinders working overtime right now. What are you talking about my mama for? I think it's this street. Yeah, it's the street. At least we don't have to run back. All right, here we go. Let's see if I still got it. There we go. $1.1. That's pretty good. There we go. That's all I had was the two. And let's see how much crypto we have. $5,500. There we go. Oh boy. I hate when that happens. Okay. That was odd. I've never looked anything else in this house, so I don't know if there's... this. Nope, you can't walk in that. God, this car is like painfully slow. Thank you. I'm starting to think it might have been faster if I just ran back. This would be a cool place to hide some shit. So crypto's done. What else do we have? Yeah, I feel pretty good. I feel like he got established well enough to get in and have a couple of things. Yeah, I'm not sure what's going on with my connection, Don. I've done everything on my end that I can do to mitigate that after yesterday's, but I will double check and see what's going on. It's staying connected for me. I'm not having any city issues connectivity-wise, but I know for streaming it's not doing it. So I don't know if streaming just to Facebook would help. If I stop multi-streaming out to YouTube and Twitch, if that would also help, but we'll see. All right, we're going back to the airport. I'm going to put up my helicopter for a brief period, and I'll be back on later this evening for Kyle Patrick's final evaluation as a police officer. So I look forward to... having some fun with that whole process. Thank you, Don. I don't get any of the notifications for YouTube, so I'll take you at your word for going in there and liking and doing all that fun stuff. I appreciate that. There we go, and we'll go ahead and do a full shutdown. There we go. And now we just need to find a good spot for me to be where I can fly in and out from.
Thanks for flying with us. Have a great day.
That's very kind of you. What's up, Tuck and Roll? That served as both a trap alert, defeating noise, and a thank you for coming in and liking the stream. Welcome back. I've always wanted to do this.
weird. Come on, then!
Cool. Boy, they really don't like you to take this one, do they? There we go. This is a fun little helicopter to fly too. It's not as responsive and it's not as fast, but it's stable and it holds its altitude really well. And it has retractable landing gear, which I think is kind of cool. Landings are always a bit smoother on these. All right. Where do I want to fly out from? Should we even try to finish on a parachute? Because last time it didn't work. And that was really irritating and frustrating for me. But why not? Leave a little Easter egg for somebody to find if they show so choose. Now all you have to do is figure out how to get up here. And unlock it. I don't know that you can get up here, to be honest. Oh well. All right, let's end this on a a fun one. All right, I will not open my menu. I will not open my menu. But we will enjoy the flight. Man. So Lieutenant Dane is in MetaWorld. I don't think I'll have enough to carry the airport. I don't know, maybe I will. Let's see. That's going to be a stretch. Well, in any event, I'll use this time briefly to walk myself out of the stream and just say, really, thank you guys. I had some peak viewership today that I have not had before in the double digits. So that was exhilarating for me, and I really appreciate it. So thank you to everybody that turned out today. The likes and the comments and the shares and the engagement. Thank you guys so much. You guys really do. You kind of make it all worth it. So with that, once I get on the ground safely here, I will go ahead and call it a stream. But yeah, man, it's been fun. Thanks for hanging. Glide slope's going to be very short. That was cool. We definitely didn't make the designated spot that we were trying to land, but that is, anytime that you come down safe, that's a good landing. Can you steal these? Yeah, wishful thinking. Where's a good place to fly out from at the airport? There's a way up to the roof. That's a start. Let's go up there. It's always fun here in the hangar. That's just because we get bored and we're simple-minded, and so it's easy to please. This is cool. Well, I've never been up here before. This is really cool. I've never been over here before. This is really neat. I spend a lot of time at the airport. I fly over this all the time. I've never been up here. It's like on top of the terminal. Another helicopter I could steal. I don't know what's wrong with me. I kind of like it though. All right, y'all. With that, I'm going to go ahead and call this a stream. Thank you so much. I'm Kyle Patrick. I'm your host. This is Kyle Patrick Gaming. Thank you for showing up and supporting Lieutenant Dan. This is a brand new foray into something that is very uncomfortable and unique and a bit of a challenge for me to do. So I appreciate you guys being so kind and so gentle while I try to explore what this character is. And hopefully the next time that I fly him in, we'll get some fun interactions. So with that, take care of yourselves. And thanks for spending some time with me today. Enjoy your Friday, and I will hopefully see you guys a little bit later on tonight. Be well.